we have the pleasure to receive Valeria Chassolon, who was a PhD student here, but now is
Alexander.
Is flying on her own wings, and it will be, she will give a talk entitled, Is Faraday in the Same Boat as Galileo, or Symmetry and Contextuality? You have the floor.
Thank you very much. Yes, thank you, Alexander, for organizing this, and you all for being present, and the chat for technical things. So we will start because we are today. And I just hope that it works. And it does. Okay, so in my title there are two parts, so there is this more specific question. I'm sorry, I'll be looking there because I don't see anything on my laptop. There's first a specific question about just two symmetries, one is Faraday's cage, another is Galileo's ship, and there is a much more general question, and I will resolve the latter and then also the former. So the latter question is about symmetry and contextuality. Symmetry is usually defined as invariance under a transformation, or a transformation which leaves something invariant. So usually you have two components, invariance plus transformation. Okay. So the easiest case is symmetry of a geometric figure, so you take a square, and if you flip it, then the shape does not change, and the orientation does not change. Or if you rotate it around its center, then also it looks as if you did nothing. So you have a transformation like flipping a rotation, and you have invariance of the shape. So this is a geometric symmetry, very easy. In physics, so I'm doing philosophy of physics, in physics you have different things which are invariant, so these are no longer mathematical objects. These can be, in particular, equations or models. So models can be defined differently, but usually one definition is a solution of equation is a model. So equation tells you about how things evolve, and one particular way to evolve would be a particular solution of equation, so this would be a model. But it can also tell about state at a particular moment of time. Take for instance Schrödinger equation of quantum mechanics. It is invariant under translations which change. It has variables position and wave function. So if you change position by a transformation which is called translation, the form of the equation will not change. Or if you change the wave function here into another which is phase shifted with respect to the first, then you still have the same form of equation, so you can say the equation is invariant, and also solutions can be invariant under this kind of transformations. So invariance plus transformation, again, you can have a symmetry. But more precisely, so this is not usually done, but I'm doing this, I'm distinguishing not only invariance and transformation, but also differences. So if you take a symmetry to be constituted by two states, so here one state and another, then there will be an invariant part which both states share, but then there is also a transformation which sends one state to another, and more precisely it changes something into something else. So there will also be differences, like the one position and another position, one wave function, another wave function, and this will be the form of equation for instance which is invariant. So now symmetry can be, you can encounter it in the world, in a theory. So suppose we're interested in theoretical symmetries of physics. So this will be now more particularly theoretical symmetries of physics. And ontology is what associates theoretical items to worldly items which are counterparts of them. So if this is now theoretical symmetry, we would like to find something in the world which would be a counterpart to this symmetry. And the question is what it would it look like. So one option is here, this kind of result is called symmetry into reality inference, and it was discussed by Dasgupta. We have not discussed much this with Alexander, so this is always a new bit. In this inference, what is said is that the invariant part of your theoretical symmetry has a counterpart in the world. So if you have a first equation and you have here a corresponding dynamics in the world, this is an ontological claim. But you can understand it in different ways, because as you know, the other components in your symmetry, so you can ask what about them. Okay, and one way to understand would be the strong way, it would say that the Sweitzkopf symmetry is superfluous in the sense that the other components besides the transformation do not have counterparts. Only the invariant part has counterparts. This would be the superfluous interpretation of your Sweitzkopf symmetry. The fact that it has, it does not have counterparts for this differences and transformation. But then you also can have a weak reading which says that the Sweitzkopf symmetry is not superfluous because now not only the invariant part has a counterpart, but also the different parts and the transformation also have counterparts in the world. This is important to for my talk. Okay, remember, superfluous means just the invariant part has counterparts, and non-superfluous means also the differences and the transformation have counterparts in the world.
Now, one way of being non-superfluous, actually there is a thing called directive radial status, but then if you put it into this more general context, which I have just introduced, and then you can say that the directive radial status is one way of being non-superfluous. So it's one way of for a theoretical symmetry to be interpreted in such a way that not only the invariant part, but also the differences and the transformation have counterparts in the world. And how is this achieved? So you take a theoretical symmetry and you match it with what is called an empirical symmetry in the world. Empirical because usually you can see it. And here is now an example. For example, take a theoretical symmetry, which is a boost. So boost is an addition of velocity. It goes from zero velocity to some non-zero velocity. And it applies on a subsystem, not the whole universe, but just some part of it. Okay, so you take this theoretical symmetry, and you can match it with what is called Carrier-Shape empirical symmetry. And the matching of a theoretical symmetry with an empirical symmetry is called the direct empirical status. Okay, so what's Carrier-Shape empirical symmetry? It's you take a ship which is at rest. You boost it physically in the world, okay? You really like activate your engine, and as the ship is now moving with a uniform speed with respect to the shore, which plays the role of your reference. So you transform it from at rest to moving. It is an observable transformation. You can observe whether the ship moves or not. But you have phenomena inside the ship, and if you are also inside the ship, then you will not notice the differences unless you look outside. You will not notice, like, if this room is boosted, the results inside will not feel it, okay? So this is an empirical symmetry, the invariance of phenomena within the ship under the boost of the ship with respect to the shore. So, as I said, theoretical subsystem boost symmetry has direct empirical status, in other words, is non-superfluous because it's matched with Galilean-Shapley empirical symmetry in the world.
And now, as you remember, the question in my title was, is Faraday in the same boat as Galileo? So actually the question is this thing, the Galileo-Shapley empirical symmetry, this kind of thing, is it analogous for the case of, case of Faraday or not? Okay, because Faraday also has observed another symmetry. Observed another symmetry, which is called the Faraday's cage empirical symmetry. So here you have a cage, you can enter, it's a huge cage. Okay, you can enter inside to do experiments. So first the cage is uncharged, then you charge it, and you see the sparkles appearing at the outer boundaries of the cage. So it's observable change. Okay, if you do experiments within the cage, you will not notice the difference. So it's again an empirical symmetry because you've made an empirical change, but it also yielded you some invariance. And so the question is the same boat as Galileo? So is there direct empirical status for corresponding theoretical symmetries in the same way as we just saw this with theoretical boost? And here he says no. Okay, so he does match this empirical symmetry with sub-theoretical symmetries, but he says it doesn't lead to direct empirical status, it doesn't lead to non-superfluous interpretation, okay? So we will return to this, but just to give an example. So one representation of Faraday's cage would be if you describe the original cage by assigned to it zero electrostatic potential, and then you transform this into some non-zero but uniform electrostatic potential. Then you can predict this Faraday's cage empirical symmetry, but here it says it's not sufficient to have direct empirical states in this case. So here it says there's a disanalogy between Galileo's ship and Faraday's cage as to the appearance versus not appearance of direct empirical status. And so this was like a particular case, a couple of particular cases, but these make part of a more general query. Okay, so if boosts have direct empirical status, and if electrostatic potential transformations, which we have just seen, they don't have, suppose they don't have direct empirical status, so we can ask which transformations have direct empirical status and which don't, which symmetries. And we can ask more generally, because direct empirical status is a way of being non-superfluous, we can ask more generally which theoretical symmetries are non-superfluous and which are superfluous. So we just generalize this query which Healy had about his symmetries. We're generalizing this to also other cases. Okay. And we are supposing that we can distinguish between these symmetries. We are not supposing that the same interpretation, that different interpretations apply to the same symmetries. We are supposing that different interpretations apply to different symmetries. Okay, and we want to distinguish between them. And so the usual reply, at least as far as direct empirical status is concerned, was that global symmetries are not superfluous and local symmetries are superfluous. And what does it mean, global local? Specified by parameters means global, specified by functions means local. And roughly this means global are uniform and local non-uniform. So global is when you add, for instance, you add the quantity and you add it at each point of your domain, okay, the same quantity. And local would be you add different quantities at different places. So within your ship or cage, you would add different quantities depending on which place of the ship or the cage you are in. Okay. So roughly global, local, uniform, non-uniform. Okay. And boosts, and this would explain well at least a part of Healy's disanalogy, because boosts are global. You apply the same velocity to each part of the ship, but electromagnetic potential transformation, so Healy discusses electrostatic and electromagnetic. Electrostatic are also global, but electromagnetic are local. Okay. So this is when you add the same potential, or different potentials at different places of your cage, Faraday's cage. Okay? And so you can say, yeah, Healy is right that there's this analogy between Galileo's ship and Faraday's cage, because Galileo's ship uses global symmetry, this has direct empirical status, and then Faraday's cage can in particular use local symmetries, and so it doesn't have direct empirical status. So you have a good explanation of why Healy would be right about his disanalogy. But we have disproved this, and we haven't disproved the classification, so we agree that boosts are global and the electromagnetic potential transformations are local, but we have disproved this part, okay? Not the classification, but this part. So global does not necessarily imply, superfluous doesn't necessarily imply global, superfluous does not necessarily imply local. So it was disproved by Gibbs and Wallace in 2014, and separately in a different way, okay? It was disproved by myself. And this was precisely what I was doing with Alexander, except I defended the PhD thesis in the center a few years ago, and it was precisely on this topic, and one of the main, the main result was that local symmetries are not necessarily superfluous because they also can have direct empirical status. And Alexander did not appreciate this, but suppose it can work. Because anyway, if you don't want to suppose it gives them all this work. They do the same, but in a different way. Okay. So, so what to do? If this explanation doesn't work, so first thing we can ask is that still this analogy if now it's not true that that local symmetries are always superfluous? Well, if local symmetries are not always superfluous, it means sometimes they are not superfluous. In particular, sometimes local symmetries can have direct empirical status. And in particular, they can have direct empirical status in the case of Faraday's case. OK? Okay, so why Healy would be wrong? Because he said that in Faraday's cage there is no directly bigger status. And now we say no, there is directly bigger status, even if it is for local symmetries. Okay, so is there still this analogy between Faraday's cage and Galileo ship if both lead to directly bigger status? And Gerson will say yes. So it's still this analogy, but it is not directly bigger status, but about what? It's about the environment. So what's the environment? Remember we were speaking about the ship or the cage. More generally, we can say this is a subsystem. Okay, subsystem is a part of the universe, but then you also have the rest of the universe, and this is called the environment. So if you want the whole thing is the universe, and then you separate the ship or the cage into the subsystem, and the rest is the environment here. Okay. Gerson wants to say. The disanalogy between Galileo's ship and Faraday's cage is that they exemplify different kind of subsystem symmetries. Okay? So in Galileo's ship, what we have, as I say, is a boundary preservedness. So your transformation on the subsystem is preserving the boundary, and the boundary here means the set of environment states which can be matched with the subsystem states. So more simply stated, okay, your subsystem transformation does not induce a transformation on the environment. Transformation, the environment can stay the same, okay? So you transform the ship, you boost it, it starts to move, but the shore is unchanged, okay? The shore is staying still. But then in Faraday's cage, this analogy would be that when you transform the cage, the environment also changes because now you have sparkles, okay, or whatever. So outside the cage there is also a change, same with the walls. But outside the ship there is no change, even if you change the ship. Okay, so this is a disanalogy. You can keep this in your mind because now I'm going to another topic. Okay, now I will be not instead of disanalogy I will be discussing this part, the correspondences between the superfluous and other distinctions. So I will be resolving another part, more general, which in my title was symmetry and contextuality. And then at the end, it will turn out that I will also resolve this kind about the disanalogy, and I will argue that there is no disanalogy. Okay. You can still find this analogy, but it will be not of this kind. So let's keep this just in our mind until the end of the talk, more or less. And let's concentrate for the moment on another part of this question. Okay? So the question was about correspondence. Remember originally, so the original claim was no superfluous corresponds to global, superfluous to local, and then Gerson also myself disproved this. Okay, so now we need another kind of correspondence. So here are some examples of what how we can proceed. So the Gupta was saying, So remember, I started when I was introducing the superfluous versus non-superfluous, I started by the Gupta's result, which is called symmetry to reality inference. So it associates a theoretical symmetry with something in the world, especially about the environment part. Okay, so this was called symmetry to reality inference, and this is an ontological result because it associates something theoretical to something in the world. Okay, and he was concerned by the question how to make it valid, how to make it work. And for this, he considered different definitions of symmetry because it was a symmetry to reality inference, okay, it was about symmetries. So he considered different definitions, formal, ontological, and he said, ontological definitions are better for me because my inference is ontological, and if I take an ontological definition of symmetry, my inference works easily, okay? But if I take a formal definition, I'm not sure how whether it works, okay? But I wanted to make it work, so I take the definition which is of the same kind of symmetry, which is of the same kind as my inference, and then it works well, okay? But Wallace has two papers which drafts were made in late 2019, and then they were published in 2022, and in between he made a talk in 2021, so I'm speaking about this period from 2019 to 2022, and last week there was my symmetry workshop, and he also made a similar kind of talk there. Okay, so it's 2019 for 2023.
this kind of philosophy. So he says, he criticizes the sculptor. He says, it's easy, okay, it's too easy. You take an ontological thing, you define another, you derive another ontological thing from it. It's too easy. Okay, you should derive ontological, not from ontological, but from formal, because it's difficult, but more interestingly, because like you start with something which is easily definable, okay? Because ontology it's unclear. You don't know what corresponds to which symmetry in the world, okay? But formal things are usually clear. It's not difficult to say whether a symmetry is global or local, okay? So you start from something formal, and then you derive something ontological, and you gain knowledge, okay, in this way. And I agree with his idea. It's interesting to explore, but I just formulated it in my way, which I prefer. Okay, so yeah, I went to the formal from ontological part. So first, okay, so several elements. Okay, I derive formal from ontological, but. In between, okay, I put substantial, so I derive actually formal to substantial, then from substantial to ontological, okay? So I have an intermediary stage, okay, then I'm claiming, since I have refuted this link between formal and ontological, between particular formal distinction which is global-local, okay, I'm saying, yeah, it will be deriving from ontological, but not from the global-local distinction. It's formal, but it does not suit, because I have this process, yeah? And what will be the relationship between the formal and ontological things? I will call it coextensionality, yeah? I will introduce a particular relationship, okay? So again, we want to derive something formal from something formal, something ontological. Formal and ontological, in my case, this will be distinctions. And so we need different relationships between distinctions. And one of them will be, this is the relationship I will be using, okay? So I'm just firstly introducing this relationship. So here is a distinction, for instance, substantial, superfluous, non-superfluous. Or having non-direct empirical status, having direct empirical status. And here you will have formal distinctions or substantial distinctions like global local or external internal or something else, okay? These are binary distinctions. So one way in which they can correspond to each other will be orthogonality. So orthogonality is when within each term of your distinction you have both terms of the other distinction, okay? So for example, within having direct empirical status, you have both global and local, or within global, you have both with direct empirical status and without direct empirical status. They are all mixed, okay? And this, on my account, this happens with the global-local distinction. Okay, it's orthogonal to superfluous, non-superfluous, it's orthogonal to global, to having versus not having direct empirical status, okay? And then there is the opposite case, extensionality, and skewness is just anything in between, okay? So the opposite case is when the first term of your distinction corresponds to just one term of the other distinction, okay? So instead of within the same term having both terms of the other distinction, you have just correspondence per term, okay? So for instance, if the original view was right, then direct empirical status would correspond to global, and non-direct empirical status would correspond to local, and they would not mix, okay? So just like this. This would be also coextensionality. And I want this relationship. But it will be not with the global-local distinction, but with something else.
Could you repeat just that? Mm-hmm. These distinctions, please.
So, maybe example is there. So, traditional view says direct empirical status corresponds to global, non direct empirical status corresponds to local. This would be coextensionality, when the terms of the two distinctions do not mix. Okay, you have correspond just like this and like this, parallelism. Okay? And orthogonality is my view against Angolas. So, you take, for instance, global, and within you have with direct empirical status and without direct empirical status. Or you take direct empirical status, and within you have global and local. So within the same term of one distinction, you have both terms of the other distinction.
represent this epsilon boson. Is it clear or not?
Okay.
So I will be seeking, again, I see coextensionality, okay? Because then if you have global, if it was right, then you derive from it ontological, okay? If you local, if it was right as a rational view, from local you would derive no non-directly because that's... I want to derive from formal ontological just as well as that. Okay. So here are now three distinctions. So first, superfluous or non-superfluous is it is the ontological distinction which I have introduced in the beginning. Okay. So again, non-superfluous means all the elements of a theoretical symmetry have counterparts. Superfluous means just the invariant part has counterpart as well. Okay. The directive legal status is just a particular case of being non-superfluous, and so. If it's superfluous, then in particular it doesn't have directive legal status. So these are ontological distinctions, the general and particular ontological distinctions. They are about the relationship between symmetry of your theory and symmetry as well. Now here is the substantial distinction, and here is the formal distinction. And as I said, I will not be linking ontological directly with formal. I will be linking with the intermediary of a substantial distinction. So substantial is not formal, but it's not yet ontological. Okay? And now I will show just briefly, because actually so far, I'm sorry, but I was mostly summarizing my talk of last week, okay? Except for this Hilleris analogy, because I need this to get to to new results. Okay, so now I finish with summarizing and then we'll get to something even newer. Okay, so I'm showing how to use my coextensionality between distinctions, how to derive something from one distinction to another. And first we go in this direction. First we just we concentrate on the on this part ontological and substantial. Okay, so what is the usefulness of the substantial distinction? So the distinction observationally complete versus observationally incomplete. Observationally complete means it preserves all predictions. Okay? So in the invariant part of your symmetry are contained all predictions. Observationally incomplete means your symmetry does not preserve all predictions. So it predicts some change. Okay? This is my distinction. And why? What is useful about it? It explains actually some assignments of ontological distinction to symmetries. Okay, so the role of my substantial distinction is that it explains why some symmetries are interpreted ontologically as superfluous or as non-superfluous. Namely, because so they are interpreted as superfluous when they are observationally complete. And Leibniz's debate with Clark was precisely about that. He was taking observationally complete symmetries, for instance, boosting the whole universe, okay? And Leibniz was saying that they should be superfluous, and Clark was saying, no, they should be non-superfluous. And the explanandum is why Leibniz's view is preferable to Clark's view, why we should say that observationally complete symmetries are superfluous, why we should say that the universal boosts are superfluous as in non-superfluous. And the explanation is that because they are observationally complete, observational completeness favors superfluous because there is coextensionality between these distinctions. So I'm using coextensionality and the substantial distinction to explain some facts about ontological assignments. Okay, and likewise, direct empirical status, we can also get an explanation there. Why is it convincing that why is it convincing that direct empirical status favors the non-superfluous interpretation? Well, because it bears on observationally incomplete symmetries, and with them they predict some change, and you can go into the world and you can see this change. And if it's right, then your symmetries are very clear, and you see that it cannot be superfluous because it predicts a change. So it means the differences which are induced by your transformation, they should have counterparts in the world which you have observed. And these are the predicted changes, as they favor the non-superfluous interpretation. So again, I'm using observational incompleteness, which is a part of my substantial distinction, to explain why direct empirical status.
this favors a non-superfluous interpretation, which is an ontological fact. And then now, what about formal distinction? So here's a formal distinction. I will return to it, but roughly it says this is the distinction between subsystem symmetries which are trivial at the boundary of the subsystem versus non-trivial at the boundary of the subsystem. So it's a distinction about what happens at the subsystem side of your boundary. About substantial distinction, a good thing was it explains a lot. About formal distinction, a good thing is that it clarifies the ontology of diffeomorphisms. So diffeomorphisms are symmetries of general relativity, and they have usually been interpreted as only superfluous. By the Hall argument. Okay, so the Hall argument says you transform something inside the Hall, but it does not, like, if it's really a non-superfluous transformation, it leads to indeterminism, but then you better avoid indeterminism, and so you should not count this as a real transformation. In short, you should interpret the diffeomorphisms as superfluous. Okay, so the diffeomorphisms would be only superfluous. And what my distinction says, no, it's only some of the diffeomorphisms are superfluous, only those which are boundary trivial. But boundary non-trivial are not superfluous. And they have direct empirical status. Okay, so here, this is where we go in one direction or another, because this part is already known about diffeomorphisms. So I first just check it with the whole argument, I go in this direction, I check that the whole diffeomorphisms are boundary trivial, and then I go in the other direction, I say, and then if diffeomorphisms are boundary non-trivial, then you should have a conversely direct empirical status, and I prove this, okay? So now you see my talk of last week if you need, because it should be online hopefully in some time, at the same website as this talk, okay? And you discover that diffeomorphisms are no longer just non-superfluous, they are also now non-superfluous. Okay. So here I finished with previous results, and finally of last week. But let's advance a bit. Okay, so I'm supposed to have proven by now that we can use substantial and formal distinctions to derive something about ontological distinctions if all these distinctions are coextensional. Now the problem is, however, that the derivation from formal to ontological passes by substantial. But there is a discrepancy between how I have defined the formal and substantial distinctions and those I have chosen, because actually my formal distinction is about the subsystem, as my substantial distinction is about the universe. So remember, we have distinguished the subsystem, environment, and the whole is the universe, okay? So this means in my formal side, I told only about the subsystem side, but I haven't told about the environment side. I haven't characterized it formally. And so actually, I cannot go from formal to substantial, okay? Because on the formal side, I have just made one half of the task, okay? Specified just the subsystem side, but not the environment side. But I need both. I need the whole universe to, at least for now, to get to the substantial side, and therefore to the ontological side from the formal side. Okay. So now we are amending this discrepancy, and this will also resolve this debate about whether there is a disanalogy between Faraday's cage and Galileo's ship. Okay. So I'm solving this. So here are my distinctions, both distinctions, so the substantial and the formal. And we want to solve this discrepancy so that we can go from here to there and then to ontological things. Okay? So my substantial distinction, okay? It ascribes some property to the subsystem plus the environment, to the whole universe. And the property is either observational completeness, so the preservation of all predictions, or the incompleteness, so the change in predictions.
And now, on the subsystem side, unfortunately you don't see much here, okay? But actually there is a gradient, okay? So it goes from gray to white, okay? So gray here, white here, and here it goes from gray to blue, okay? So white means there is no transformation here. And blue means there is transformation. Gray means unspecified, okay? So in my formal distinction, what it says, boundary table symmetries and the boundary of the subsystem, they don't change anything. They are identity here, okay? And if they are boundary not trivial, they change something here at the boundary of the subsystem. And then our task is to specify formally the environment so that the whole thing gets, okay, yields either observational completeness or observational incompleteness. And here we return to this distinction which Gins and Wallace introduced to account for the disanalogy between the Galileo ship and Faraday's cage. So remember they said, no, both cases yield direct empirical status, but one is boundary preserving, so the boosts are boundary preserving, and the electromagnetic potential transformations are non-boundary preserving, okay? So the distinction, it was about subsystem symmetries, but it was characterizing the effect of them on the environment, okay? So in case of boosts, when you boost the ship, as you remember, the effect was the environment does not change. And then when you transform the cage, the effect was that the environment changes. But more precisely, there is an induced transformation which is quite strong near the cage, but then when you go away, it disappears. So it fades away, okay? As I said, I already have my distinction about, formal distinction about subsystem, and so the proposal would be, how about adding to it this another distinction which is about the environment? And then I would get both, yeah? I have something about subsystem, something about the environment, okay, great, I combine this on the formal side, and I should get something about both sides at the substantial level. That would be a proposal. Yeah, thank you. So why not combine my distinction with Gins and Wallace's? Okay? And never mind. I said let's combine the distinction, but we should modify Gins and Wallace's distinction before it can be combined. Because their distinction has a drawback, okay? It is a distinction about the environment, but it still concerns the subsystem. It's a distinction about how the subsystem transformation influences the environment transformation. It's not a distinction about environment transformation per se, okay? It's about the influence of subsystem on the environment. But I want a distinction which would be just about the environment. And why? Because when you are speaking about subsystem environment, it looks like subsystem is primary, environment is secondary, okay? But actually, these are just two parts of the universe. And they are alike. You can even switch the labels. So what you are calling the subsystem, you could call it the environment and vice versa. So actually, there is no reason to say that the environment is always subordinate to the subsystem and that nothing happens there except if the subsystem influences the environment. This is not true, okay? We should treat the environment just as if it was another subsystem, which means, in particular, you can transform it independently of the environment, even non-trivially transform. Okay, so I'm taking this in Wallace's distinction, but I'm amending it, okay? I'm admitting independent transformations of the environment, okay? And now, let's see what this yields. So first we consider boundary preserving transformations. These are transformations when you transform one subdomain, it has no influence on what happens on the another subdomain. But you can still transform the other subdomain just independently. Or you can leave it untransformed. Okay? So if we consider sync of boosts again, so we are adding a velocity on some subdomain, either subsystem or the environment or boost. Okay? So Wallace in his, so it's one of the papers which is called the observability and something else for dynamical symmetry transformations, okay? So it's written between 2000
19 and 2022, and presented last week again. So here he distinguishes between subsystem globality and subsystem locality. Subsystem globality is when a non-trivial transformation on the subsystem plus the same transformation on the environment amounts to the symmetry of the whole system. And subsystem locality is when identity, unspecified transformation, which is actually identity, or something similar about the subsystem, combined to identity on the environment, is the symmetry of the whole. So these are notions which have, on his view, these are formal notions. Okay, they have nothing to do with my substantial distinction about observational completeness and observational completeness, but his claim is that from these formal notions, you can derive something about either substantial or ontological about what he calls observability and non-observability. Okay? So if your symmetry is subsystem global, so you again think of a non-trivial boost on the ship, you add to it a non-trivial boost on the environment, the whole is the symmetry of the universe, then well, it says it has observability in the sense that when you transform just the ship and keep the environment untransformed, you get the ship empirical symmetry. Well, he doesn't say that, but I imagine that. Okay? He says you get observability. And he says if your symmetry is on the contrary subsystem local, so when you couple it to subsystem symmetry to identity on the environment and you get the symmetry as a whole, okay, this is called subsystem locality, then you get the observability. So he's trying to derive some, from something formal, something observational, ontological. I just reformulated this in my theorem, and then it happens that this is already not formal. This is already observational. Okay. So this is the case, as I said, you boost the ship, you boost the shore, the whole thing is the symmetry of the universe and it needs some symmetry. It doesn't predict any change in the environment, therefore it doesn't have directly empirical status. And the same is in both sides are identity, not directly empirical status. And this is directly empirical status. You boost the ship, you keep environment the shore, and you get a symmetry which corresponds to Galileo's ship empirical symmetry. And here you feel that we are getting to our question of this analogy between Galileo's ship and Faraday's cage. And it looks like, so first, as I said, I replaced Worlitz's notion. I said they are not formal, they are observational, just like this. And then you see there is something missing here, isn't it? Let's just add it. There is a fourth case, actually, okay? Which is just like the previous, except that now what's not really transformed is the environment, instead of the subsystem. So you don't boost the ship, but you boost the shore. And the whole is again Galileo's ship empirical symmetry, because you still observe the relative displacement of the ship with respect to the shore, which appears after this transformation. And the reason why Wallace missed this transformation is because he did not consider the environment as being transformable independently of the subsystem. He was thinking that either environment is identity or at best you induce some transformation from the subsystem. But the novelty, my novelty which enables this extra case is that I admit independent transformations on the environment, the amendment which I have just proposed. And last but not least, as I said, actually these four cases are all non-formal. If all the cases are not formal, then we get to our previous question, which was from which formal things should we derive these non-formal things? And I have this formal thing from which these four cases can be derived. So here's my proposal. Here's a formal property from which I claim these substantial and ontological properties can be derived. The formal property is called boundary state preservingness or boundary state non-preservingness. So what is this? So you have a boundary between the subsystem and the environment. And on my account, what explains whether you have observational incompleteness or completeness, whether you have directly empirical status or not directly empirical status, is what happens with this boundary. Is it changed or is it preserved? If it's preserved, so here you transform both things, so you don't change the relationship between them. The boundary is preserved, therefore you have observational completeness and non-directly empirical status. The same here, you don't change the boundary, the relationship is the same as before, and therefore you have this set of distinctions. But if you change just one of them, just some subsystem, or just the environment, you have changed the relationship between them at the boundary. And this implies on my new observation on completeness and dynamic status. So yes, here's the formal distinction, here is a substantial ontological distinction which are coexistential in the sense defined. And so we are getting well in time to the question how to resolve our beautiful this analogy between galeoship and Faraday's cage. So what I have just explained, this was a paradigmatic example where boosts which correspond to galeoship. And now we get to electromagnetism which corresponds to Faraday's cage. So the previous symmetries, they were boundary preserved. So when you transform one of the subdomains, it does not influence the other. If the other is transformed, it's because you transform it independently. Okay? But now we get, instead of boundary preservingness, we get to boundary non-boundary preservingness. So this means that when you transform one of the subdomains, it influences the other. Okay? Well, if we actually examine Hilly's theoretical symmetries, we say that not all of them are boundary, boundary preserved. A non-boundary preserved, okay? So, at face value, it would seem that boosts are all boundary preserving, and electromagnetic transformations are all non-boundary preserving. Actually, no. Within electromagnetic transformations, you also have boundary preserving, so the same, which look just like boosts, which means you transform one thing and the other does not change. So these are theoretical symmetries, okay? So second and third symmetries which Hilly associates with Faraday's cage are boundary preserving, okay? Boundary preserving. You transform one side, the other side does not change. These symmetries are explainable in the same way as just beforehand, okay? They are actually the same as my fourth case. You transform the environment, you don't transform the subsystem, you change the boundary, therefore you get observational incompleteness and you get direct typical steps. The same observation, the same analysis carries over to these two symmetries, okay? But there is also the third symmetry, and here is finally the non-boundary preserving symmetry of classical electromagnetism, which describes Faraday's cage. But these two also describe, okay? But we also have a new case, okay? So it's non-boundary preserving, which means when you transform the subsystem, you also transform the environment. But the environment transformation, it fades away, okay? So here it's still near the subsystem, it's still like you transform a lot, but when you go away, finally it becomes identical, okay? And the question, how do we explain this in my terms? Because remember, the explanation was that direct empirical status arises when you have changed the relationship between the two. But here it doesn't seem like you have. Okay, well, at best you have changed somewhere away from the subsystem, but at the subsystem environment boundary, the explanation is more or less the same at both sides. Okay, have you really changed something? So it's it seems to be a problem for my account. And I'm not sure how to resolve this, okay, but I have at least a few options. So one option is, the first representation, these two are actually in terms of potentials, but this one it is also expressed in terms of potentials, but is actually what it expresses are field strengths. Okay? And the usual way of understanding the classical electromagnetism is to say that predictions are governed by field strengths. They are not governed by potentials, but by field strengths. Okay? So the explanation would be, perhaps you don't have really a change at the boundary here, but this is just one representation in terms of potential, but the main representation is in terms of field strengths, and there you do have a change. So that would be one option. But to explain why we have direct empirical status here, even if the boundary seems to be unchanged. Okay? Another explanation
is now we, instead of we can like compare these two, we will compare these two and another two representations. We can say, okay, yeah, perhaps here is no change in the boundary. So we will think that there is no direct ambiguity of states, but this representation is linked by a gauge transformation. Which has a specific form, okay, to another representation also in terms of potential where we do have a discrepancy at the boundary because we have changed the environment but not the subsystem, okay? And so the, another solution would be, yeah, we don't have the discrepancy here, but this representation is linked to another where we do have a discrepancy, and then again, that's why we have directly because status here, and therefore also in the linked representation. And the third option would be to say, yeah, perhaps we don't have really a discrepancy at this particular place, but we, if we see a bit more away from the boundary, then here we have a uniform transformation, and here we have a non-uniform transformation. And so here there's probably still a discrepancy because we are passing from uniform to non-uniform. So these are three explanations of how to account of direct ambiguous status for non-boundary preserved transformations, even if the appearance of a discrepancy is not obvious at the boundary. And so finally resolving the disanalogy. Okay. So what I was doing so far was to mostly. From my title, there was a question about disanalogy, but then there was a symmetry and contextuality. So I was discussing this general question about how to link distinctions, and then now I will show how to resolve disanalogy using it as well. So concentrate on this last representation. Okay. So remember, it was I was operating in terms of just two subdomains of the universe. It was there was a subsystem and there was an environment, and it was supposed to be all. Okay, actually it's not all. Okay, actually so what you will see is now I will add a third thing here. Okay, so now this will be not just the environment. Okay, it will be an approximate environment. And then there will be another thing which I have added, and this will be called distant environment, okay? So approximate is near the subsystem, and then the distant, which is away from the subsystem, okay? So now I've added more environment into the picture, okay? So the previous picture was not complete, actually. This is the right one. And now we can say that the symmetry is non-boundary preserved, it affects the environment, but it affects just the proximate environment. It doesn't affect the distant environment, because at some point you remember as this inference of the subsystem transformation fades away. By now we have here a density, okay? So the symmetry is non-boundary preserved at this boundary, but not at the distant boundary. And this is, I have not included this, but Alexander knows there is Simon Friedrich, which was in my committee actually, in my PhD committee, and he was saying that this was an objection to saying that the symmetry has direct ambiguous states, because he was saying something like, but if you continue your environment transformation, it will fade away, and then you will not have direct ambiguous states, and so on. So this is, I can also resolve this in my approach. But since I was promising to resolve this disanalogy, okay, so I'm doing this. Now I'm eliminating, okay, I've just eliminated the distant, the proximate environment, okay? So first I added the distant one, and now I eliminated the proximate, okay? And now we compare just the subsystem and the distant environment. And what we see is that, actually, at this boundary with respect to distant environment, these two representations, they would tell you that there is no direct ambiguous status. Yeah, because actually when I was editing it, you see in these representations, the transformation is only in the proximate environment. It's neither in the subsystem nor in the environment. So when you meet the proximate environment, there is no direct ambiguous status at all because there is no change in relationship, okay? And now it's this final representation, which on the contrary helps to ascribe a direct ambiguous status to the others, because in this representation, you have a clear difference between the subsystem which is changed and the distant environment which is not changed. So you have a discrepancy at this distant boundary, and it leads to direct ambiguous status. And now the crucial thing is that I've changed nothing here. I've changed nothing. So this was the previous slide about Hillis, Faraday's cage. And now just the same slide, but you see I've changed just the name, okay? Now exactly the same thing applies to actually to boosts. Yeah? Because you remember boosts were when you change the subsystem, you don't change the environment, but you have direct empirical status. Now, what was the gain? The gain is I'm claiming that the usual analysis of boosts, it's right, but the environment it's speaking about is the distant environment. Yeah, remember, it speaks about transforming the ship with respect to the shore. So my claim is the shore is a distant environment. Okay. This claim is compatible with saying that in this case direct empirical status arises. But it raises the question, what was the proximate environment? If the shore is a distant environment, what is about the proximate? And in the proximate environment, what I'm claiming is that the situation is precisely the same as this Faraday's cage. Namely, the subsystem symmetry is non-boundary preserved on this environment. So remember, boosts are usually called boundary preserved because they don't transform the environment. But if they only if the environment which they don't transform is the distant one, then it's still possible that they transform the proximate environment. And I'm saying that they do precisely this. And you can ask what is this proximate environment in case of the Galileo ship, okay? So the distant one is the shore, but what is the proximate environment? Well, the proximate is just the water and the air, okay? Because the ship is not in some flying away, okay? It's surrounded by some media, okay? Like water and air, and it transforms them because if you go through the air, through the water, you have friction, and it affects the ship, but also this media is themselves affected to the ship. You have an exchange of heat and so on. Okay, so this is non-boundary preserved for the influence of the subsystem of the environment, the subsystem transformation of the environment transformation, which is omitted in usual analysis of boosts because the environment they concentrate on is actually just a distant environment. So so what this means, as I said, keep in mind this picture. Okay, I go a few slides back. And we get just the same picture. But the last picture was about Galileo's ship, and here's the picture about Faraday's cage. So the resolution of the disanalogy is that the disanalogy is simply because we concentrate on different parts of the environment and not different boundaries. But if, and because the pictures are incomplete in the analysis of Galileo's ship and in the analysis of Faraday's cage, so the disanalogy disappears when we consider the whole picture for both symmetries. Okay, so in the usual Faraday's cage, you concentrate on just the proximate side. On the usual Galileo ship, you concentrate on just the distant side. But combine both for each case, and you will see that they are the same. There is no disanalogy. But you can still generate it if you by switching your attention to different environments and to different boundaries. And there's Friedrich's, I didn't put it here, but I have it in my text. Okay, so the Friedrich's problem about direct empirical status, which seemed to arise for subsystem symmetry, but then it's supposed to disappear because the environment transformation can be continuated to identity. It's also resolved by saying that direct empirical status is relative to a boundary. Since I have derived direct empirical status from this discrepancy at the boundary, then different boundaries can have different states of discrepancy, and some of them yield the direct empirical status and others don't. So the fact for Friedrich, when Friedrich says that direct empirical status disappears, no, it does not disappear. That just means that it arises at the boundary, it doesn't arise at another boundary. But the fact that it does not arise at another boundary, it does not imply that it disappears at the first boundary. It's just relative to boundaries. And yeah, here we are. So, Dasgupta started by saying that you can derive ontological things from ontological notions, and Wallace says, but it's trivial, you should derive ontological from formal. And I say, yeah, it's possible. Yeah, we can derive ontological from formal by the intermediaries of substantial, in my case, And the distinctions are more precise. The ontological or superfluous, non-superfluous, in particular norm versus standard technical status, substantial was observationally complete versus observationally incomplete. And the formal is what I have transformed. So firstly it was boundary trivial versus boundary non-trivial, subsystem symmetries, and then I extended this to symmetries of the universe, but actually then it was not the universe which was important, but just the boundary between subsystem and environment. So my formal distinction is finally boundary state preserving boundary state changes. So changing whether you have discrepancy at a particular boundary, whether it's changed or not. And so I have resolved the disanalogy between, dissolved the disanalogy between Galilean shape and obfuscation. And in my title there was symmetry and contextuality. So why I'm saying that in general we have contextuality here, because as I said, observational completeness, I predicated it on the universe, but actually in light of my formal distinction, which is ultimately about boundaries, this one is also about boundaries. But anyway, it's about not just the subsystem, like Gibbs and Wallace distinction. It's neither about the environment, it's about both. It's about the boundary that is there. Okay, so it's relative to, it's contextual because it depends on which, because the same subsystem transformation can have or not have directed legal status depending on which environment transformation you couple it with and vice versa. And directed legal status, observational completeness, and so on, these are contextual properties because they are not properties of one of the sides but of which of the things it's coupled with on the other side, or more precisely, it's the property of both sides together and not each of them separately, okay? And each depends on the choice of boundaries. So for different, I was distinguishing between subsystem and distant environment and proximate environment, but you could also combine proximate environment and the subsystem and call the whole thing the subsystem, and then you can call the distant environment just the environment, okay? So it doesn't matter how you call them, but what matters is that you can put boundaries at different places, and therefore, since my formal distinction is about the boundaries, is determining the other distinctions, you will also have substantial and observational claims which are dependent on the boundaries and therefore contextual. That's all, thank you.
Thank you.
discussion. Oh, okay. So I have a. So it's me that is supposed to do the comment. I will do a very short general comment.
Do you want to come here, maybe?
You can turn the camera.
Sure.
No, but no, the microphone is okay.
It's okay. It gets the whole room. Yeah.
And after that, I will do a very small question about the specific case Faraday versus. So, for people outside the field, there's something important you have to understand is the way the debate is framed now about this ontology of symmetry. If you read Leibniz and Clark, they are discussing about the world, and they use symmetry as a probe. Okay, discuss, if we move all the universe from 1 meter, is it the same universe? Leibniz says, I don't see any sufficient reason that it's not. And Clark says, I don't care about the principle of sufficient reason, so it's not. And he has another reason. There must be a specific frame that exists in which God wrote the laws of nature in one single valid formulation. So the debate was not about the kind of transformation, it was about the world. But once physicists discover group theory. Group theory is the standard way physics, I say physics because of course in mathematics symmetry is not limited to group, is the way to frame symmetry. And of course if you frame symmetry with group, you're talking about transformation. And you qualify transformation. And all this debate between Haley, Wallace, before, is all about kinds of transformation, what can I deduce from the world, from the kind of transformation my theory has. And only very recently, and with people like you, they began to say, oh, maybe we should talk about the world a little bit. Because it's not obvious. Maybe there's empirical consideration. But it's extremely weird, because it's really debate. If you read papers of Wallace in particular, it's debate about kind of transformation, mathematical, blah, blah, blah. And it's not, it's very general, very abstract, that kind of symmetry, that kind of ontological consideration, formal to ontology, independently of what you're talking about. So I'm ashamed to say that I did not read again, Wallace and Healy to prepare for this comment.
But it was not necessary.
And I'm very ashamed because I think I should have to comment better here. Because based on my fuzzy memory of when I read this paper, it's probably the last time you were here, so it's 4 years ago. My impression is that you answer well to Wallace, but it's less obvious that your argument is against Healy. Maybe it's complementary of Healy. Let me elaborate a little bit, and that will be my question. So, the paper of Healy is extremely strange. It's perfect symmetry. It's a very bizarre paper. There's a completely impossible to understand appendix at the end. There's consideration about intrinsic, extrinsic property in David Lewis, which no philosopher of physics ever considered because it's metaphysics.
Except the Wallace, no. In the
but it's metaphysics and philosopher of physics. What? But I think it's important to understand what was the goal of Healy. The goal of Healy, at least the goal as I see it, is there a way to differentiate identical situation from equivalent, dynamically equivalent situation? All the discussion, the disanalogy between Galileo and Faraday, which is, they are very close empirically, the symmetry, they are formally almost the same. But he says they are not the same because in the case of Faraday, you have identical situation before and after, inside, not in the world, but inside. So he's talking about intrinsic properties, the same intrinsic properties inside and outside. And he's claiming, I don't know if he's right, that in the case of Galileo, you don't have intrinsically the same situation in the ship, the ship moving, the ship not moving,
even if they are dynamically indistinguishable. So I don't know if he's right, and I don't know about the metaphysics of intrinsic properties, but I think that's his claim. And how do you know that they are the same? You take cage zero potential, cage at a certain fixed potential, and you put the boat cage near the same. And you take guy on the shore, guy in the ship, and you okay, well, not the same. Okay. It's crude, but I think intrinsically he's saying that movement is relational. So in K, so it's different when you're not moving compared to your reference frame or when you're moving. And I don't know if he's right about that, but I think it's what he's claiming. And to have different static potential, but fixed static potential, so without the differential is zero, it's metaphysically the same. But of course, this debate between metaphysically the same and equivalent, physically equivalent but not the same, cannot be captured by discussion about transformation, because they are the same, except if you enter this very weird external environment. I don't know, maybe something outside the universe. So people, the argument after that will say, but let's make a transformation on ED, and we will have to add an external to the external.
Yeah.
And so you see how the empiricist technique will be limited if the claim is about metaphysical intrinsic properties. Maybe he's right, maybe he's wrong, maybe we should not do that. But I think his argument is about that. Instead, Wallace is an argument like you. It's an argument about empirically frontier and non-frontiers and environment and where you can argue more efficiently against Wallace. But that's it. I need to answer, and after that the floor will be open.
Yes, thank you very much, Alexander. Yes, so there are three things. Okay, so the last one was shouldn't you add something else here again and so on? Yeah, that's so what Wallace says in his new articles. So he says the cosmological assumption is that, also in the Gibson Wallace article, it is that the physics is essentially about the universe. And as he proposes to deny his own assumption and those of many other persons, so this assumption, he says, no, physics is essentially about subsystems. Which means, and then he says his article is about how to extend them to further subsystems or how to go back. But so yes, he says we can start with a small one, but then we can add another, and we can consider what happens with the whole, and so on and so on. And this is called subsystem recursivity, and in the name of recursivity, you see that it can be, he meant that you can go back and forth and interpret again, but in the recursivity, there is also this extra sense that you can apply it again and again. Yeah, and you can go into guaranteed subsystems. So yeah, this was just not the core of Alexander's comment, but I just clarified this. And then which situations are similar and which are identical? So there are again two things here, but. There's one thing about Healy actually thinks that we don't know what is identical, what is not, or which situations are duplicates and which are not intrinsic duplicates, but it's the series which tells us, okay? So there's this new dimension that he's not presupposing any claims about what is the same and what is different, but he is
say that let's associate our series what happens in the world with some theoretical representations. Let's make these representations maximally symmetric, so they should be symmetric not only in the predictions but also on the underlying levels. So, for example, delete all absolute quantities because this introduces the unnecessary asymmetries. And then we get the result, and he said that now we will be using this result as a guiding principle. So it will tell us which situations are intrinsic duplicates. Okay, these are those which can be represented as such. And now I'm going to your final, the third point.
You avoid my question. Because yeah. In Hille, it's not what he said. In Hille, of course he's saying we need the theory to describe the world. So he's a philosopher of physics, so it's not a metaphysician. But he's saying the difference is between I describe the situation on the shore, I describe the situation on the ship, and I have also a model where I have a ship and the guy on the shore doing both experiments. So he says people like Wallace, they describe model one, model two, symmetrical, and they never think submodel one, submodel two, inside a bigger model, which is in the theory also, which will show you or not if it's identical or not. Okay. It's the weird annex at the end. It's about that.
I'm coming to this third point, which was the first. Is there this analogy between conditionship and confiscation in the sense that one is about intrinsically identical situations and one is about just similar situations? And second question, can we have representations of confiscation because similarly where both cages are inside? This is what in the matrix both are inside the same. Yeah. So firstly, this question. Suppose this was about economics, but that was just you just using the science. Okay, so suppose this is about the ship. Okay, suppose this is about the ship. So this will be about the ship now. Okay, so forget this boxing environment, and then so here is saying that when you boost the ship, you transform it from a stationary to moving state. This is a different state. Okay, when you boost the ship from stationary to moving, you make a difference, and the environment is unchanged. But when you transform the cage, you can transform it in such, you can represent the transformed state of the cage in such a way that the cage will be untransformed. And these representations, okay? So this is the final state of your cage, it's untransformed. This is the final state of your ship, but it is transformed. Okay? So what Alexander said, that this analogy was that when you transform the ship, you go from stationary to moving, but when you transform the cage, you actually don't transform it because you go from uncharged to uncharged. And this was this could be a disanalogy, okay?
But then at least for Hille.
For Hille. But how did he get this disanalogy? Actually, he was obliged to transform the environment, because if he transformed nothing at all, then he would not be able to represent the sparks the other worldness of the cage. So he exhibited some representations of Galileo ship of Faraday's cage where the cage is not transformed. But it was at the price of transforming the environment. It's possible that for the ship there are also such representations. If you use local symmetries. So what follows from my account is that you have...
You're still talking that the ontology is given by the transformation. And this is not what Hille is saying.
You
just show how the debate is done now. Okay, it's done. Let's discuss the type of transformation. If I can show you the transformation is formally the same, it's the same ontology. But my impression, but maybe it's me, my vague memory of healing, is that healing is about the fact that it's not just the transformation outside that is important. Because we could say, okay, let's change an atom on the moon. Doesn't change anything here, symmetrical. Did we discover something ontological about the world? We would say, no. So it's not the fact that the environment changed that is important. It's the fact that inside the cage, nothing changed. Whatever you do outside.
But are you making an empirical claim or a claim about the presentations? Because what Hilo was making is a claim about the presentations.
And my impression is that he believes, right, wrongly or rightly, that it's not the same for the shape. Maybe you should not understand movement like that, and you could say, okay, maybe it's not the right way to understand the thing.
As far as I remember here, he makes a claim about the presentations, about the theories, okay? He says, empirically, the two cases are the same. The difference is theoretical, which is, what is the difference? When you represent Galileo's ship by a theoretical symmetry, you must transform the subsystem. But when you represent Faraday's cage by a theoretical symmetry, you need not transform the subsystem because you can represent it as unchanged, but on the price of transforming the environment.
That's the difference between a perfect and imperfect symmetry in the paper, if my memory is correct. Perfect symmetry
does not
change intrinsic properties.
The difference between perfect and imperfect symmetry is we can take the example of velocities. So imperfect symmetry, both changes of relative and absolute velocities likewise preserve phenomena. But if you change relative velocities, we transform the universe. Okay, relative velocities are preserved, absolute velocities are changed, predictions are preserved. So imperfect empirical symmetry is the one with absolute velocities. It preserves predictions, but at the underlying level changes velocities, absolute velocities. This is imperfect. The perfect symmetry, it preserves predictions and it preserves everything underlying. So it abandons absolute velocities, now we have just relative velocities, and it preserves the symmetry of the universe. Preserves predictions and preserves relative velocities. It's perfect because it has no underlying asymmetry.
Yeah, because it preserves the intrinsic properties the same. It's the difference between identical, metaphysically identical and metaphysically equivalent, or dynamically equivalent.
I'm
insisting. You can answer something else if you want, or you can give the floor.
So Healy is only interested in changes of intrinsic properties, yes. But he distinguishes observable intrinsic properties and unobservable. So strong symmetry only The strong symmetry only preserves observable intrinsic properties, and perfect symmetry also preserves unobservable intrinsic properties. And then he says, but we don't know which properties are intrinsic. And he says, well, see what symmetry preserves, and this will be your guide to what is intrinsic. Yeah.
Is there a question?
I just wanted to just tell
that.
When I was saying that Hilde argues that Faraday's cage does not yield direct empirical status, okay? And but then I said we disprove this and so on. So I was addressing just one aspect, but of course Hilde has other arguments. You were saying that I have not completely addressed it, but it was not important for my talk, but of course he has other arguments why there is no direct empirical status in the case of Faraday's cage. But these arguments also do not work. So he says that electrostatic potential transformations, they would have direct empirical status if electrostatics was right about our world, but it's not right because actually systems are moving and electrostatics is only about stationary systems, and that's why this direct empirical status is not really realized. But this argument does not work because special relativity, which has boosted the its symmetry is. It's also not really right about our world, because you have general relativity also. So if this argument was working, then he would not have a directed beam status even for Booth. Okay. And the second argument was precisely this analogy that when you have electromagnetic electromagnetic potential transformations, they don't have directed beam status because they can represent the subsystem as a change on the bias of changing the environment. But I think this is just they are able to do so because they are local, and that's why it's not a good argument to say some symmetry doesn't have directed beam status purely because it's local. But it's just the fact that it's local or global. But how do you link this with ontology? You can't blame a symmetry on just formal grounds. When I derive ontological claims from formal claims, I'm adding something. I'm claiming that there is a correspondence between formal and ontological. But you cannot say merely because a symmetry has some formal feature, it does not imply anything about ontology. You need to specify the connection and all this, then it will work. So saying that a symmetry doesn't have directed status on the pure grounds that represents the symmetry as a transform, but why are you sure that this precludes the critical status? What is your justification? Okay, you haven't postulated a link which would justify this. So this argument doesn't work as well.
Kevin, you had a question?
Sure. Thanks
a lot.
Let me start with the graphical equation. I'm not sure I've understood how you make the difference in what is the proximate environment and distant environment. What are the physical features that allows you to discriminate to what is proximate? Like a closed environment and far environment?
Just the distance from the subsystem.
Okay, but then there is no clear cutoff then.
No, but they are interesting senses. I mean, you can claim that water is sufficiently uniform. Within the water, anything is sufficiently uniform, and within the shore, anything is sufficiently uniform. But in between them, you have a clear difference which you can describe in terms of physical properties, like what is a liquid, sure is not, and so on. So you can have a clear cut this way.
Okay, but physically speaking, then I don't see how this relates to the question of the symmetries of the system, but not like the symmetry of the system and the symmetry of the environment. Then. If you feel there's like a not more clear cut definition, the distinction between both of them, like a something of a question of negligibility of forces or something like that. I'm not sure I understand how it relates to the question of symmetries.
Sorry, I didn't understand what is the query. Is that it's a symmetry of the environment as the subsystem?
I understand how the distinction with the distant environment and the closed environment matters here.
For the analysis?
Yeah, because it seems that, except if you are making some high cutoff of when our forces are negligible at some point, then you don't have to take into account the very far environments, then you would be forced to take all the environments itself, just because the question of symmetry, right? You have to take it for the whole years, or at least the whole causal years in the same environment, right? It's not easy to.
You mean that the effect?
I'm
not quite understood, but maybe you mean that the effect of subsystem transformation will be felt very, very far away? Or?
Yeah, all you have pragmatic reasons to make a cutoff because you feel that you're looking at the forces at a certain order of energy or something like that, and then you make a cutoff because at some point maybe the force becomes negligible or something like that.
Okay, so your question, you can say that this fading away, it should stop not here, but actually very far away.
Yeah, I don't see how you can get the physical difference.
In your theory, you can perhaps postulate action, the difference or whatever. Yeah, but actually, it's for
observational purposes, after some point your measurement apparatus will not be sensitive enough to get this. So it will depend on if your values, you have values 1, 2, 3, yeah, and then you can, okay, you can cut, it's not 1, it's not 2, but I can still say it's 1/2, yeah, but then you divide and you get to a practical impossibility to discriminate between very small values and so on. It's the same here, so. Yeah, but for some things, like if you touch the cage when it's charged, you will feel something. You can be even like some persons can be dead because yes, if it's too charged too much and you touch it. But if you don't touch, you will not see. So it this kind of proximate effects. It only works when there is really a touch. So for some effects they will not even fade away, they will be only present here. And for others, there is a causal horizon in special relativity, so for some events they are too far away, you will never get any causal effects from them. There is observational limit, like you are in front of the ocean and you see it until the horizon, but then at some point, if the ship is farther away, you will not see it, and if it's closer, you will see. So practically, there are always grounds to distinguish between where the effect is still felt or where the is not, even if in your theory you can at least model it as a never fighting way completely.
So it's a grammatical definition of what is far, what is close, right? So it's kind of grammatically how you implement the.
It's pragmatic in the sense that it's said it ourselves, but it's still objective in the sense that it's the world which says us. That when you touch, you feel an effect, but when you are 2 meters away, you don't feel an effect.
The world will tell you where to get between what is far and what is close. Technically, if you look at the theory, if you tell you that more or less up until the end of the universe, you have at least something for field theory. Maybe it's close to zero, or arbitrary close to zero, but also that you still have some kind of.
As the world says, when you have an effect and when you don't feel it, but it does not tell you how far away you should say that it's zero rather than very, very small. Yeah.
So you say it's pragmatic in the sense it depends on what we can measure.
It depends on what you want.
It depends on us.
So what we're interested in.
Yeah, so the question is how you make the jump to metaphysics from that. Mm-hmm. But that's kind of the issue, yeah, because.
That's an interesting point, because if you include that such distinction between what we want to measure or what we can measure, or that goes a little bit against the Wallace paper, where it was always full manifolds, and he was arguing against most of the debate on symmetry, saying these guys did not work on all the manifolds with blah 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 frontier condition. But if you say no, that's not how physics works. Physics works about subsystems, like you said, and we have maybe two kind of beyond the system, beyond the system where we can see something, beyond the system where we cannot see something. Who cares about the complete manifolds?
But as I said, so Wallace denies his own assumption. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So he was saying Gibbs and Wallace. They were analyzing in 2014 in terms of the whole universe. Yeah. And then he says, no, I made an error. Instead of the whole environment, we can consider just a small part of it. Yeah. So he's denying. He said, I was making an error, many persons were making it, no, let's stop making it and concentrate on subsystems, because physics is essentially about subsystems. So this is what is called, physics is about the universe, it's called cosmological assumption, and in his new papers he says, let's deny this assumption.
Yeah, but nobody was confused between a global symmetry applied to one system and global symmetry applied to the universe. That's because nobody was confused about that, except theoretician and philosopher of physics, because they work with the complete manifold all the time, so they cannot make the distinction in their head. But nobody empirically was confused about that. except us, you know, philosopher of physics, and ask them pages of my dissertation about this distinction that makes absolutely no sense outside outside theoretical physics. That is really, nobody empirically would say, oh, okay, a boost, oh, yeah, is it the universe or just, nobody has used that in empirical physics.
Well, so
in theoretical physics, it's very difficult to make the difference.
Yeah, but then you just confirm what he said, because he says physics is essentially
about
physics.
But what I'm saying is that even if he tries to be not in that direction, maybe the fact that he works with manifolds, it's already... No, he cannot make this distinction.
No, now he can.
Now he can? Okay, maybe I'm not up to date.
But he is not... So I was discussing his articles, as I said, the draft were in 2019, bit after my PhD, and publication is 2022, and he presented last week again. But he is not... So he still considered one or two, but I imagine the third of it makes some difference. But his system is such that you can add as much as you want. So in principle, and still not reach the whole universe. So now you add the net and you still speak about subsystems. It's just great to ask.
Are there questions, comments? Kevin?
That's good to follow. So then if you're starting to get problematic with this kind of distinction, why do you care about theories or symmetries? Why do you look at the symmetries of upright and bottom? Because then, as Alexandre said, the issue comes from looking at the theories in the isolation, and you try to relate them, adopt to the world. But if you start taking parametric consideration of how you define the system, empirically speaking, or experimentally speaking, I mean, that is, nobody uses theories, empirically speaking, when you use closer models to experiments. The question it seems between it's a defect, but what you're showing is that there is a defect in the original interpretation of theories and symmetries in the theoretical sense.
Mm-hmm. But the defect, it's not in the theories, it was in the interpretation. So his claim was that we theories are fine, but just we were interpreting them wrongly.
Yeah, but that's kind of the issue, that they are only considering, they are too high of an abstraction.
But I mean, it was not for him a reason to abandon the series. He was saying just let's interpret them in the right way.
Yeah.
But we are not abandoning, or he was not proposing was to switch to different models. He was saying the models are right, but you just misinterpret them.
No, I'm not saying to switch the models, I'm saying to switch from analysis of the development of theory and how theory relates to the world to analysis from more empirical models. How theories work, because nobody is using these theories as food stuff and money from non-political settings.
But there was some attempt to do that. Lady Man, when he discussed about the friction on the boat, on Galileo boat, so you know that the boat moved because you have a heating effect?
Yeah.
That's the empirical models, and we see a difference.
Yep.
So that, and Ely, if I remember, maybe there's a passage of the paper about if there's two cages next to each other, so in the high one.
Yeah, that's a kind of what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
So the analysis, they run into problem because they don't want to go free, they try to remain at the vertical level.
No, but I'm saying that they try sometimes to have a more applied model, closer to the kind of model that would be tested.
But we're still within physics. We're not abandoning physics.
No.
We just added more physics because the friction is modeled with a suitable physical theory. Again, the point is just like your theory is just about the boost, or you want to mod theory which also explains friction. So yeah, so I kind of told that this example of what happens with. Between ship and water is from Ledesma's manuscript, but he is not using it in this way. So he's used this to say that water affects the ship, and I'm doing this way out because I want the influence on the environment. So I'm saying the ship affects water. They both get changes in temperature and so on. Yes, but we still say we stand with the physics, we just stand in no physics. But I'm not saying that the original interpretation was bad. I mean, not about the universe as a subsystem, but about the one which abandons blocks in the environment. It just tells less information, but it's still correct that we it correctly predicts that the ship is changes with its visible behavior with respect to the shore, and the predictions inside are changed. Yeah, but Alexander, yes, so I interpreted differently. So he is in appendix B, where I took this from. So he is, has the same thing, but this is the changed, the final state of the subsystem. And this, for him, is the original state of the subsystem. So he uses the same thing, but to represent the like the special change in between two cages. One of them is in the original state, and the other is in the transform stage. But I'm interpreting the original cage as the environment. So instead of, but it's essentially the same, because he was saying that he just like. In his case, the difference is special, and in my case, it's temporal. So in between original state and the final state, where he'll have time, which has, and here is special. So, but the analysis will be the same. So, this could be the environment or the original case. You will still have something to say about what happens in between.
Other questions, comments? Could be a naive question or pseudo naive questions.
Pseudo naive.
There's Americans, I don't know.
Pretend like it.
But do you have questions online?
The kind of question a lot.
Keeping an eye on chat, I don't think so.
Is there a question?
There are many naive questions, but they are not doing justice to the work you did, so I feel a bit embarrassed to ask them even. A naive question would be, like, you talk about co-expansionality, uh-huh. Right? While all of these notions seem modal in nature, so are you really interested in whether something has the same extension? If we are talking about intrinsic properties and so on, like whether it's intrinsic or not may not be an extensionally visible thing, but that's super naive and very metaphysical. But also, like, another modal consideration I had was, like, if you're talking about the boosting, is there like is it important that there is a sort of intervention of the boost, and so there really a physical process, or is it like the first situation of the boats, and then in a possible world, another possible world, you imagine a situation where the boat is moving, or must there really be some sort of intervention, and what does that say about interventionism and so on? I mean, super naive questions, and if you don't have anything to say about that, that's
No, of course I do have thank you very much. Of course there is a model dimension to this debate, but it's mostly not what you were saying, but I will say what is usually model. But at the end you said what is really model in Hilly's way of understanding the debate. Yeah. So he says that for him the situations, so here are transformed states. Yeah, so you have original state of the ship and transformed state of the ship or the cage. So for Hilly it does not matter whether the states are actual or possible. If it's possible, then you just have direct bigger status with respect to possible worlds. And if it's actual, then it's with respect to actual world. So the difference, so why he was saying that there is no direct bigger status for electrostatic potential transformations, he meant just in our world, because as I said, because electrostatics is not right about our world. So it's he says, electrostatic potential shifts have a direct empirical status in the world where electrostatic is true, which is not our world, but in some possible world it has, yeah. And the difference was for him that, but boosts have a direct empirical status in our world, because I would complete his argument, because the special relativity or whatever is true of our world. But then I say, no, it's wrong. Special relativity is no more true of our world than electrostatics is, because the objection to electrostatics is that it models only static systems, those which don't move. And we have moving systems which also exhibit electromagnetic phenomena, and that's why we need electromagnetism instead of electrostatics and so on. Okay, but the special relativity is also more than just a limited kind of phenomena, and then we have general relativity, which is more general and which involves phenomena which special relativity does not model. So actually the both have like the bigger status in the possible world if this kind of argument applies. But of course, in fact, it's not a good argument, because you can have data bigger status with respect to whatever you want in a possible world, but what we're interested in the ontology is mostly about actual world. Alexander was saying that ontology of physics is about what would the possible world look like where theory is true, but it's not actually the questions we are solving, because the important question is whether our theory predicts what happens in our world. Whether it's true about the actual world.
Yeah, because in our world we do experiments and we manipulate things to see which modal properties
hold. You're linking this with intervention, so it looks like what's important is intervention, but for this topic it doesn't matter whether it's we who intervene or whether it's like some natural process and we discover that one planet, suppose one planet is stationary but another is moving, we can just discover it without doing anything, but we can still ask whether phenomena within that planet, or the moving and the stationary planet, whether they are the same, and that would still be an individual
simple sound difference. It's not important for the discussion.
It's not important
whether
can
you have
intervene.
Agentive or something like approach to this boosting, or whether you just look at planets.
Yeah, exactly. So it does not matter whether we can intervene or whether it's just a natural phenomenon. What matters is whether both states are actual or not, because if they are possible, then how do you know what really obtains? Well, you just rely on your theory, you suppose that it's true, but it's not the question we answer. We answer whether it's true of our world and not what the world would be like where the theory is true. So what matters is that both states should be actual. At least sometimes, and but it does not matter whether we bring them about or whether they just naturally happen to be stationary.
But yeah, it's more than that, because if you look at the symmetry as a kind of transformation among models, okay, it's a possible world. We don't care. Maybe one is could be actual or not, but. You forget your own dissertation. You know, there's a big part of your dissertation about. How can we say there's an empirical status associated to one of this theoretical symmetry among models? And if my memory is correct, you claim, maybe I could be wrong, you claim in your dissertation that to empirically sustain that it is a real empirical symmetry, you have to be able to differentiate a natural possible transformation from something that looks like a transformation. Maybe it's identical, but it looks different because. There's something substantial if you want to claim direct empirical. DES, direct empirical symmetry. That you have to be able to know. This is a real transformation.
Yeah, but this is identifiability. This is what I call the observational incompleteness here.
Okay.
So this is the idea that two states should be empirically distinguishable. There should be some difference which you can observe between them. So in the ship case, one is moving with respect to the shore, another is not moving. This makes observational difference, and this tells you that these two states are indeed different. Perhaps they are different in the way which you have not seen, but then you don't know, perhaps they are the same. And that's why I was saying, yeah, you need this observational incompleteness for identifiability of the transformation. Yeah, but there is another thing which is about two ways to realize empirical symmetry. So one is when you really transform one state to another, you boost the same ship, but another is when you compare two ships. And this was already proposed when one stationary another boosted or two planets. And this was already proposed by Brezin and Brown. And I was claiming that these two ways are equivalent. So in my account, it's not important. We are not obliged to transform one thing into another. We can just compare two different things which exhibit this observation of different properties, but also some invariance. And this would still be empirical symmetry. In this sense, we don't need to transform. how else modality is involved. So Wallace, in his paper, it's called Observability, Modality and Redundancy for Dynamical and so on. So he wants, I was explaining how from formal you derive observational and ontological, but he also wants from formal to derive model. Okay, and in principle you can also do this with my approach. But as to my material, where model seems intervened was in this part, which I was not much telling about. So you have Belt's article of 2018, and I was not remember was on our conference 2017 when he was presenting that note. So he has an article which is called like 50 million Elvis fans can be wrong. So, yeah, because the physicists the claim is that so Elvis fans are right. I mean, if they like Elvis, then so it's no question whether Elvis is good. Because and the claim, Bell's claim is physicists attribute they take states related by symmetry of the universe to represent different possibilities. This is a model thing, yeah. And since physicists do this, philosophers should follow them. So physicists are always fans; they can be wrong. And so philosophers they should. If physicists represent take symmetry related states, symmetry on the whole universe to represent this impossibility, then philosophers should also do this. So this is model claim. And what I'm doing in this material about diffeomorphisms. Because symmetries Bell is interested in are even boundary non-trivial diffeomorphisms. But I need them to be subsystem symmetries to get the right interest. And he interprets them as symmetries of the whole universe. And I'm saying, no, you should actually he starts by interpreting them as subsystems and he goes into the universe. And I say, no, you should revert to the subsystem because of Wallace's denial of the cosmological assumption, for instance, which says physics is essentially about subsystem. And so I revert from a universal subsystem, but I keep all the trivial symmetries, and I am saying that they have, therefore, they have dynamical status. And I explain what is unexplained in Bellot's article. Why do physicists think that symmetry related states represent different possibilities? He just says, they think so, and the philosophers should also think. And I'm saying, no, because. And then these are symmetries of the universe, and we say no, they are symmetries of subsystem, and this explains why they take symmetry-related states to represent different distinct possibilities, because these are theoretical symmetries, because they correspond to different states of empirical symmetry, which can be actual or possible. And that's why they interpret, okay, theoretical symmetry-related states correspond to distinct possibilities, because they do correspond to distinct possibilities. But this happens when you have directly, because that's when you have a correspondence with an empirical symmetry in the world, or in Hilly's way, where one or both states can also be possible. So this is modality.
Thank you.
Okay, so time's up. Time for continue the discussion around a beverage.